Truck Talk Media.
C10 Talk, episode 216. Brad Swaney, Uniontown, PA. Kid gets a truck when he's 14. Kid builds a truck. Kid takes the truck to SEMA, enters the Battle of the Builders, and wins the Young Guns category.
The vision never really changed, but as time went on, I got more carried away with it. Where, like, when I first started, I wasn't getting overly carried away. But then as time progressed, it got kind of more out of hand and out of hand as years went on.
Damn, son.
Hey, guys, I've got David Odegaard, product manager, United Pacific Industries. David, what's the latest?
You know, one of our hottest items is the side mirrors with the directionals built into them, the LED arrow. You know, these look cool. They look original. And however, when you're driving at night and you're changing lanes, that guy that sits in your blind spot, we all know who he is. He'll see that you're indicating and you're coming over. And there's a great safety factor with these mirrors, and they look cool too.
Blind spot guy, we don't want you there, but the United Pacific side mirrors, they work great. I have them on Orange Slice. I love them. How about the guys that are looking to go long bed to short bed? What are you guys offering them?
Yeah, we have all the parts for the 67 to 72 bed, you know, new bed floors or whatever you may need, a new bedside, or that bed front that's always been smashed in by 50 years of stuff being, you know, hauled in the bed.
Yeah, these trucks have been worked so hard over the years. We love that about our trucks, but you might have a floor that's dinged up. You need some parts. United Pacific's got it for you. What else are you guys working on?
Later this summer, we're going to have the front parking lights for the square body 73 to 80. These are full LED. They've got the deluxe stainless steel trim around them. And, you know, it's just a plug and play installation. And it's that final missing piece to convert your square body completely over to LED.
Perfect. So if you guys need some directional mirrors, some bedsides, bed floor, or maybe some LED lighting, United Pacific, upcarparts.com. That's upcarparts.com. But wait, there's more. You could save 15% by using code C10TALK15. That's C10TALK15 to save 15%. Thanks, David.
Thanks, Ronnie. We'll see you out there on the road.
Let me tell you what Melbourne Post is packing right here. I've got 411 Posi Track out back, 750 double pumper, Edelbrock intakes, Ford over 30, 11-1 pop-up pistons, turbojet, 390 horsepower. We're talking some fucking muscle.
What does that do? Does that blow your mind?
That just happened.
Welcome to C10 Talk, your C10 truck podcast.
And now I have a chance to be the best, maybe the best in the world.
My old man is a television repairman. Got this ultimate set of tools. I can fix it.
I said I got 50 cents in that jukebox, and all I can hear is your mouth clapping. You hear that?
Here's your host, Ronnie Wetch.
What's up? What's up? C10 Nation, 216 coming at you. Brad Swaney, Uniontown, PA. What a great story. Glad to finally lock this one down and bring it to you guys. I think you're going to enjoy it. Huge thank you for all that took advantage of the summer sale, our big summer sale. We had it for about a week, and you guys killed it. So we do appreciate that. Orders are going out. We started sending them out Friday, Saturday, and everything else should be out by hopefully Monday, Tuesday. So appreciate your patience on that. Shipping out orders, there was a lot of them. You guys really responded. We'll stock back up for show season and getting some new gear out there. But we do appreciate you guys taking advantage of that. If we had something that was out, keychains and some of that stuff will restock. Some shirts, probably not. So it really just depends. But again, thank you guys so much. Episode 215 with Chaz. That one's doing really well. If you guys haven't had a chance to check that one out, get on over there. Check out 215. Chaz's interview will be up on YouTube. And then at the end, there's going to be a shop tour. So that should drop probably the same time this drops. I've been kind of putting them Tuesday to Tuesday. So episode drops on a Tuesday, and the following Tuesday I'm getting the videos out. I did that same thing with 214 with Michael Roleri, Salvage to Savage, Cha-Ching C10. So a little shop tour there at the end of the YouTube video. So the pod is there, so you can see the video if you want to watch, you know, myself and Mike, myself and Chaz, and then shop tour at the end. So get over there to the YouTube and like and subscribe on the YouTube channel, which is Truck Talk Media. Truck Talk Media on the YouTube channel, and you can check out the shop tours on both of those. Couple pods coming your way, couple YouTubes, staying busy, busy, busy. Tim Strange over there on the sister station, OBS Talk, if you know who Tim is. He's built a shit ton of C10s. He's built a shit ton of hot rods, a few OBSs along the way, and you name it. But Tim Strange, a.k.a. Rod Builder, over there on the sister station, OBS Talk. What else? Bronco Talk's got a cool one. A family that loaded up in a 72 Bronco during the pandemic, and they said, hey, our kids are homeschooled. They got two boys, a 10 and a 12-year-old, and they got a little turtleback camper, and they're going all over with a Coyote Swap 72 early classic style Bronco. So that's a cool one. Cool adventure, and I'm jealous, dude. They're having fun. So check that one out. That's over there on the Bronco Talks. All right. Let's get into some shows. I'll let you know what's going on there. I know it's back-to-back, so it's not like it's not fresh for you guys, but I've got a couple new ones to make sure I announce because you guys are listening, and you're like, hey, what about this one? What about this one? So this coming weekend, June 12th in Waxahachie, you got the classic truck Nats. That's, I think it's America's Classic Trucks. America's Classic Trucks. June 12th coming up this weekend. Then the following month, July 9th and 10th, SETN, Southeastern Truck Nationals, Wilson County Fairgrounds, Tennessee. Get a hold of the C10 Deputy or C10 Club Tennessee and get yourself registered. All right, he's thinking over 1,000. So he has continued to get bigger out there. Biggest C10, biggest truck show east of the Mississippi. We sponsor three awards. C10 Nation, I think, sponsors 67 to 72, best. OBS Talk, best OBS, 88 to 98. And then best overall is C10 Talk, I think. Either Talk or Nation could be swapped, but either way, we do three awards out there. We sponsor it. We've done that for, I feel like, 6 or 7 years. So stoked to always get behind Brian on that. Okay, that's July 9th and 10th. Now, there's a new one, and that's July 17th. I got an email from Roland Blaine. You know who you are out there, Roland. Thanks for the email. This is a free show, Independence, Missouri, and it looks like it's at the Cable Damar Arena. So if you know where Independence, Missouri is, at the Cable Damar, I hope I'm saying that right, D-H-A-M-E-R, Damar Arena. It's going to be the C10 Shindig. Now, he sent me a flyer, C10 Shindig. He emailed it over to me. It does say Roland. Let's see here. Now, it's not Roland. So it looks like the CK guys, C10 and Classic Trucks behind this one a little bit here. So it'd be interesting to say or see how this one does. I believe it's the first show. It says it's the Heartland's largest GM truck event. So I don't know in that. I think this is the first year. So not sure about that. We'll see how it all goes down. C10 Shindig, Kansas City, July 17th. So Independence, Missouri. Another new one on the other side of the world out in Cali, July 24th, the C10 Slowdown, SLO. That's in Laguna Lake Park, and that's in San Luis Obispo, California. C10 Slow, SLO. Get it? San Luis Obispo. Down. C10 Slowdown, July 24th. August 1st, Brothers 22nd Annual Show and Shine, Silverado Park. Okay, and they're back. So they skipped last year, but that's August 1st. I'll leave you at that. Well, August 14th, C10's on the Capitol, Olympia, Washington. Pacific Northwest, Todd and Jen Manchester are behind that one. August 14th. We'll take you up to there. That's how far I'll take you, because I've been repeating those, and we got a couple new ones we had to sneak in there. The C10 Shindig and the C10 Slowdown coming at you. All right, guys, I'll hold off on the reviews. Let's just get into the podcast with Brad. Thanks, as always, for tuning in. Brad Swaney, 216 coming at you. Thanks for tuning in. Like it, love it, share it. You know what to do, guys. All right, have a great week. Late. All right, C10 Nation coming at you, Uniontown, PA. We've got Brad Swaney. I tell you what, Brad, love to have young guys on the show. Welcome to C10 Talk, and thanks for sharing your story with the C10 Nation, my brother.
Thanks for having me.
All right, let's jump in, man. I think I first got exposed to you probably when I got a Summit Racing catalog in the mail, and there was your truck right on the cover. So before we jump into that, let's just talk about who Brad is.
Brad's just a small town boy from Uniontown, just has a little hot rod shop with his dad. That's about it.
Okay, how'd you guys get into that?
My dad's done body work his whole life, and he's built some hot rods. And then I just got into it, and I really had an interest. So when I got out of high school, this is what we decided to do, was open a hot rod shop.
Now, before that, was your dad just playing around, or did he work at a body shop?
He had his own body shop. Then he worked at the power plant for a while, and then he realized that wasn't the answer. So he got back into body work, and everyone does body work. So he wanted to do something a little different. So we do more of the custom stuff now.
Okay. Now, do you do the painting in-house? Is your dad your painter?
Yeah, dad paints, and I paint both.
Do you have a part that you like the best?
Believe it or not, I like block sanding, like poly primer and stuff. That's like, I don't know why, it's just something I like.
Yeah, you're like there's one in a row, because you're the only most guys that like to paint, they hate that crap, and they prefer to lay down the paint. You know, they're the artists. They don't want to do all that work.
Yeah. It's all about the prep work. Anybody can paint.
Do you have a part that you don't like?
I don't like to get greasy, like disassembling some old greasy thing. Just not for me. I do it, but it's not what I like.
Okay. So you broke up just a little bit, but I think you said just the greasy part. So you don't like some guys got an old truck that's just, you know, flinging grease and oil all over the place. And then they bring it over to you and they're like, here we go, Brad, take care of it.
Yeah, just not for me. I don't like the greasy stuff.
Do you ever get one in the shop that comes in and it's a little bit oily or greasy, and then you have to, you know, dad says, hey, get over to the pressure washer and clean this thing up?
Yeah, we got a Pantera right now that we just started tearing apart, and that's how it was. The whole thing was just a ball of grease. You couldn't look at it without getting covered.
You were like having nightmares about it. You go home and you're like a big old blob of grease, and you're like, I want out of this thing. I want it crisp and clean and no caffeine.
Yeah,
I bet the shop's pretty nice if you don't like all that oil and grease.
No, I'm pretty much a neat freak. It has to be all neat and tidy for me.
All right, well, that's a good start. I think you'll attract a lot of customers that way. So you're in Uniontown, PA, which isn't too far from Pittsburgh. Go Steelers. Do you get a lot of clientele from Pittsburgh, or do they come right there from Uniontown?
Most of them's from Uniontown area. We have a real good customer from Smithfield, about 15 minutes away. We've done a couple cars for him, but most of them fairly local.
Okay, so let's start off about your C10. How did you get this truck? How did it all start?
My dad's had it since the 90s. He got it in like 93. He was going to do it himself, and then he gave it to me when I was 14 because he realized he was never going to do it. And then I was just going to daily drive it. I was 14. He figured he'd give me an old truck and I'd start to work on it. And after I got the frame done, we realized it's too nice to drive. So I had to buy another truck and build a driver out of.
So you get it when you're 14. How old do you have to be to drive in Uniontown?
16.
Okay. And that's pretty much the United States, but I think there's still some Idaho, Montana, where it might be like 15, some of the more rural, maybe Iowa, I'm not sure, but I know in Montana and Idaho, I'm pretty sure you can be 15 and drive. I don't know if that's still how it was. I know when I was a kid, my buddies were driving at 15, and I had to wait till I was 16. So you had it for 2 years before you even could drive it. I'm sure your dad, and growing up in Uniontown, you probably drove it beforehand, I'm sure.
No, actually, Dad had it since the 90s, and it was just in pieces since he got it. It was just a ball of parts.
So it wasn't even really a truck.
No, it was just a bunch of parts.
Well, that's a so he gave you a jigsaw puzzle and said, figure it out.
Yeah, basically. Figure it out, and it helped me along the way.
So that's kind of cool. He didn't think he'd ever build it. He ended up helping you build it, I assume. And would you say that you cut your teeth on that truck? Or had you already been around Dad working hard for, you know, let's say a good 4 years prior to that?
Yeah, since I was old enough to walk, I was painting something. I mean, bicycles, pedal cars, you name it. I painted it when I was younger. But that was the first, like, overall big project I tackled.
So what kind of shape was the truck? Were the parts pretty dry or were they rusty? And you were just like, man, you gave me a basket case here, Pops.
The cab had its fair share of rust, you know, people hacked on it before, but he bought all new old stock parts in the 90s when he got it. It had new old stock doors, a fender, tailgate, wheel wells. So it had a lot of nice parts to go with it.
Well, there's a gift, I guess. So he handed you a basket case, but at least he had bought it at the time where you could still get NOS stuff. And you weren't having to deal with some of the aftermarket stuff that might be a little more tinny.
Yeah, it's really nice stuff, you know, really nice to work with good quality, you know, GM metal.
What was some of the struggles you had to work through, you know, during the build?
Mainly just knowing like where to stop, like how far do I want to take this project, you know, because I like to go overboard with everything. I'm never satisfied. So I have a hard time knowing when to stop and when to keep going.
So give us an example. When's a time where you know, Dad's like pulling you back? Was it a time thing or a money thing or both?
A little bit of both. You know, you got to work on something else, make some money, order parts. And then, you know, like I said, I wanted to drive it originally, so I had limited time to get it done. But then that snowballed and we had to do another truck to drive. But it all started, I sandblasted the frame, and you know, old frame, it's got pits and whatever in it. So I epoxy primered it and filled all the pits and everything in. And then we realized, well, it's too nice to drive now. So we had to move on and get something else.
What'd you end up getting?
I bought an 89, like four-wheel drive truck that was my grandpa's. He bought it brand new.
Do you still have that truck?
Yeah, I daily drove it for a while, but since then I've moved on and got better trucks to drive every day.
So you've got your 71. It's obviously in immaculate shape. You had an 89. How long did it take for you to either, were you driving the 89 as soon as you got it from like, so you 14, you get the truck, you figure out there's no way I'm going to get the C10 ready, you know, by the time I'm 16. And then when did you buy the 89 from your granddad, grandpops? And then were you driving that right at 16?
Well, I bought the 89 when I was 15. And then I got right before Christmas time. Then I got a lift kit for Christmas. So then it snowballed and we tore the frame out of it, sandblasted it, and put a lift kit on it. Then we decided, well, since it's a part, we'll just paint the truck. And it snowballed too. So it was almost too nice to drive, but I did drive it.
So you're 16 and you had two trucks and parts, or did you get it done in time to drive?
I did get the 89 done in time to drive. A little after 16, but I did have it done.
I like your style, man. What great problems to have as a young man. You've got a 71 you're working on. It's a little bit carried away, snowballed. And then you get, you know, the OBS from granddad you know, it probably got away from you. So I get the sequence now when you say, hey, I need a project manager, you know, maybe writing checks for me here because I want to go a little bit too far. I think now as a guy who, and we'll get into what your occupation is now, but as a shop owner or co-owner, that's probably a great problem to have for some of these, you know, clients, as long as they're willing to let you get carried away.
Yeah, we have one customer and he lets us get carried away, do whatever we want. He just leaves it totally up to us and we do whatever we want to do and he's fine with it.
So are you and dad the same, or are you a little bit more yin and yang, where maybe he has a little bit more self-control and kind of helps you with that?
I definitely got it from him. I mean, he can't leave anything alone either. He's, you know, has to be perfected.
God bless your mom.
Yeah, she has a handful.
Okay, so you turn 16, you get the 89 done, you've got the driver. You got a name for the 89?
Old Blue.
Old Blue? Yeah, that counts as a name. I mean, if you say, hey, we're taking Old Blue, you throw somebody the keys and you're like, we're driving Old Blue today. So you're driving Old Blue, you're 16. How long does it take till you get the 71 done?
The 71 didn't get done until 2018. So it was quite a few years later. I believe I was 21 when I got it done.
Was there times where you really stalled on it, time and or money or job or different things?
Yeah, there was times when I didn't work on it much, but then the fall of like 2017, I decided I'm taking it to World of Wheels in Pittsburgh in January. And for 6 months, that's all I worked on. Dad didn't have any help in the shop. I just worked on my truck.
How do you pay your bills at that point? Are you still living at home?
Yeah, still living at home, just living the dream.
All right. So I'd have to do the Mesa Public Schools math on this, but 2017, you're grinding. Did you get the truck in 21 minus the 4, 5, 6? Did you get the truck in 2012 or 2011?
Honestly, I don't know. I would have said 12. I know it was the year I was going into high school.
All right. So you, well, whenever you were 14, what year were you born?
97.
All right. So yeah. So 97. So 14. So it'd be close to that, either 2013, 2014, regardless. So you were 14 years old and yeah, maybe even 01. Let's carry the 1, 14 and 10. And yeah. Making us do math here. But so you had it for a while. And then you stalled out at times. Was that hard as a creative guy, a guy that, you know, wants to build it? Was that hard to keep? I guess how far did the recipe change from the time that you were getting back on it after Old Blue was rolling down the strip? You're back on the 71. And then from that time, how much did the vision, the build change because it had, you know, been a few years?
The vision never really changed, but as time went on, I got more carried away with it. Where like when I first started, I wasn't getting overly carried away. But then as time progressed, it got kind of more out of hand as years went on.
Give me an example. The paint, the body, the motor, the interior.
Just all of it. I mean, like I started out, like I said, going to drive it. And then every piece I touched, I just had to make it perfect. And I wasn't satisfied till it was how I liked it.
Okay. So you go to 2017 and you're like, I'm going to get this thing in World of Wheels. That's probably the biggest show in Pennsylvania.
I believe so. I would say at least in the Pittsburgh area.
Okay. How did things go in 2017?
When I first debuted it down there, it won best truck overall. And, you know, I wanted to get in the Steel City 6. That's their like, you know, highest thing you can get down there. But they told me that I went and got the judges sheet when the show was over. And they told me they found orange peel in the frame because it wasn't sanded and buffed smooth. And it was dirty because I was on a time crunch to get it down there. But other than that, they didn't find anything wrong with it.
So that frame, that chassis was the same one you did when you were 14, 15 years old?
Yeah, that's the same chassis that was in it when it debuted.
Okay. Now, what'd you do after that?
After that, I went to some Good Guys shows, won some awards at Good Guys shows and so on. And, but that whole, ever since they said there was orange peel in my frame, it just haunted me. And I had to change that. I had to make it better. So me and my buddy got an idea one day, and we found a donor frame in Richmond. And we drove down there and got it. And then I got to work on a new frame. And this new frame, I've welded all the factory holes up, and actually I cut all the cross members out of the frame and bolted it back together with stainless ARP bolts and welded tabs on it. And all my fuel lines are inside the frame and you don't see any of them. And then when I was all done, I sanded and buffed it smooth and then bolted it back together. So there's no orange peel in this one.
Man, you were fired up about that. You're like, I'm going to show you guys.
Yeah, and I did.
I want to see some pictures of that. Hopefully you've got some pictures either on your phone or somewhere where we can see that new chassis sitting there, maybe next to your truck. Do you have a name for your truck, the 71?
No, I don't. I never named.
Okay. So 5-6 years to build the truck, the vision stayed about the same. What about that color? That's one of those things that really draws at least me to the truck. Obviously, when I first saw it on the cover of Summit Racing, I mean, it's I like the burnt orange. I like the earth tones. How'd you come up with that color?
I had a color in mind and I looked through chip books for years and I just couldn't find what I had visioned in my head. And I had a model car, a little 41 Willys car, and I took it to the paint store and they took a picture of it. And they actually mixed me a custom color based off of that little model car.
So when you see a little model car and then they mix you up a batch, I assume they made you a little quart or something and you went home and sprayed it on something. You didn't just go all in, right?
Yeah, I got 4 ounces and did a spray out and I realized that's what I had to have.
Okay. It appears to me that the truck has a little bit of a personality disorder. So sometimes it looks darker and sometimes in the light it looks, you know, kind of sparkly. Do you have some metallic in it? You know, break that down for us.
That color, it's like one toner and a whole, like two whole bottles of pearl per gallon. That's all that's in it. It doesn't have like a bunch of crazy toners and stuff. It's one toner and two bottles of pearl. It has a ton of flop in it and it just goes crazy in the sun.
Yeah, it looks so cool in the sun. Were you pleased with that? Were you really happy with that?
Yeah, that's what I had envisioned, but I just couldn't find it in the chipbook.
Okay, I think through translation there, you couldn't find it in a chipbook. Some reason our my Cricket Wireless or our Wi-Fi is not working all that great. So did they give you a name on that? Have you kind of come up with your own name? Have people asked you about the color and where they can get it? Because I assume it's probably pretty popular.
Yeah, it's real popular. Everybody asks me about it, but I won't give it up what it is.
You need to sell it. So you don't want to tell anybody because then everybody will paint their, that was that Tangelo Pearl, House of Color Tangelo Pearl, probably 10 years ago. Man, if you saw it once, you saw it 100 times.
Uh-huh. I don't want my color to be like that.
Okay. How about wheel selection?
I had in mind, I wanted a different set of wheels from Billet Specialties, but they couldn't make those in the like offset and everything that I wanted on my truck.
When you're looking for classic Chevy or GMC truck parts, brotherstrucks.com is your number one source for 1947 to 87 Chevy and GMC truck restoration parts. So whether you are restoring an original or looking to customize that classic truck, brotherstrucks.com has thousands of the highest quality truck parts for you to choose from. So head over to brotherstrucks.com and order your free catalog today. And don't forget to follow Brothers on Facebook and Instagram for daily updates and special offers too.
Hey guys, are you thinking about swapping out your old motor for a more reliable LSLT based power plant? We've got great news for you. PSI Conversion is offering our listeners 10% off your order. Behind each PSI harness, you get over 10 years of experience in the business, online tech support, phone support, and harnesses made in the U.S. That's PSIconversion.com. And don't forget, use code C10TALK and save 10% today. Hey guys, did you know that US Mags and American Racing Wheels have true lineage to one another? And that US Mags was created in the mid-60s by none other than racing legend Parnelli Jones and his childhood friend Art Hale Sr.? Well, fast forward around 50 years and you'll see that Art's son, Art Hale Jr., who grew up in the wheel industry, obviously following in his dad's footsteps, acquired the name and the iconic American Wheel brand. Talk about rad. Amazing history, amazing story, and amazing wheels. Check them out at us-mags.com. That's us-mags.com.
I had in mind, I wanted a different set of wheels from Billet Specialties, but they couldn't make those in the like offset and everything that I wanted on my truck. So these were like kind of my second choice, but I'm glad that I ended up having to get these ones because they're spot on. They just really do the truck justice.
Yeah, it's funny. Growing up, your dad and I, probably about the same age, five spoke is, you know, torque thrust style, coys. And now with like a 10 spoke, it just adds a little fanciness to it. And obviously you've got a high end with the Billet Specialties. You kept your bed floor the same. It appears the same stock height. You didn't raise it because the truck isn't really slammed, but you went with a wider rear wheel tub. So you're running what size wheel are you running in the rear?
It's got 20 by 12s in the rear on a 345 tire.
How about up front? 20 by 9?
20 by 10s up front with a 295.
Okay, yeah, there's definitely some meat there.
Yeah.
Okay, what about the bumpers? You color match that?
Yeah, not Frenched in, like the tail light, the license plate light and some stuff in the back. Just cleaned it up a little bit from a stock one.
How about the motor? What made you end up thinking I'm going to go with a big block?
Well, my dad painted a Chevelle for a guy years ago, and they did some trading, and he ended up with that big block, and that's what he was going to put in it. So he just figured that's what would put in it for me.
Yeah, and then in Swaney fashion, you guys, everything's chromed out. It looks fancy, and I'm sure the motor is done to the hilt.
Mm-hmm.
Did you guys bore it over? Is it still a 454?
It's 30 over. Actually, it was built like when he got it. And then, you know, it sat around for 10, 15 years. So we had buddies of ours tear it apart and go through it, make sure everything was all right in it.
How about exhaust and mufflers? Because, with a big block, and I'm sure there's a cam in there, they just sound so mean anyway. And then you put the right either manifold or header with the right muffler. What manifold, header, or muffler are you running?
It's got a Hedman headers on it, and then it's got polished 3-inch stainless exhaust with Magnaflow mufflers.
Oh, I had Magnaflows on Yellowstone, which was a 454, and man, I love that rumble. You know, just sounds so good. Well, I've got Flowmasters on Orange Slice, and I probably like that even more just because it gives it an old school, kind of an old school rumble. But either way, the Magnaflow sounds real sexy on those big blocks. I'm sure it sounds really mean. I can't remember. Are you running a 4-speed or a 5 or a 3-speed or a 4-speed?
It's got a 700 R4 in it.
Okay. Built, I assume.
Yeah. Friends of ours, Paul Fertile, he has All-Star Transmission. He built it and he does an excellent job on these 700s.
Okay. And then rear end, your gear ratio, and you narrowed it probably because of your little bit wider in the rear.
It's a stock width still, but it's got 373s in it.
Okay. It'll scoot. What was your least favorite part of this build?
I didn't really have a least favorite part. I mean, everything about it was a learning experience, so you can't go wrong with learning new things.
Anything you'd change if you could change it?
Well, I did want to change the frame, but I already did that. So I'm pretty satisfied with it at this point.
Well, you should be. Obviously, you've gotten some awards. You've gotten some print. So, I guess the first thing to come was the Summit catalog. So you take it to some good guys show, you win some awards, you take it to World of Wheels, You get Steel City. Oh, no, you didn't get Steel City 6. Did you ever go back and get back in that or let those judges take another look at that chassis after you redid it?
I took it to World of Wheels two times after that. But to get in the Steel City 6, it has to be your first time ever being there. So I was ineligible for that. But I won best truck overall again with it. So that was, you know, that's always cool.
Yeah, good. Congratulations. That's, I mean, and that's cool. That's also cool that they don't let you keep bringing trucks or cars back. So kudos to them on that, I guess. But I love that they motivated you on that. And you went back to the drawing board and redid and fixed what you had to do. Mm-hmm. So how does a guy end up in, you know, every car guy's mailbox? If you think about it, I would say the circulation of a Summit magazine rivals any publication out there. Absolutely rivals any publication, because my kid gets it, I get it. You know, they're giving those magazines to that catalog to anybody and everybody that, you know, orders a part. So your truck was in a lot of mailboxes.
Oh yeah.
How'd that happen?
Well, believe it or not, I was down in the garage late one night primering, and my dad called me and he said, "Hey, you need to come home and I need to talk to you." Well, a guy we go to all the World of Wheels shows with, Summit contacted World of Wheels because they seen it at the World of Wheels show scouting for something to put on the cover of their book. And they liked my story and that I was young and everything. So they contacted World of Wheels, and World of Wheels didn't have any way to contact me. So they contacted a friend of ours that we go to the shows with, and he got a hold of me to reach out to Summit. And they wanted to put me on their book. And when Dad told me all this, when I was down in the garage primer, and I thought he was just lying to me, because that's everybody's dream. And how'd I luck into this?
So what'd you do? What happened? You're like, hell yeah, let's do it.
Yeah, I called Summit and they wanted to schedule a photo shoot in one of those like a studio with like no corners and stuff, had the rolled walls and everything. And it was unbelievable. I never thought that my little truck would be on the Summit Racing cover.
So did you have to take it somewhere to get it shot, or what'd they do?
Yeah, I took it to Akron at some studio out there that's close to Summit.
All right, cool. Yeah, so you go visit Boris? Do you ever go see him over there if you're over in Ohio? Do you know who Boris is?
Uh-uh.
Street Machinery. You probably seen him online or Facebook. Yeah,
I've heard of him. I didn't know that's who it was.
Yeah, Boris. He's a pimp. No, literally, he's a pimp. He just pimps out rides all day long, freaking buying and selling. And yeah, you need to show up at his place someday with your truck. He'd probably like that. But they don't make him any better than that guy, I'll tell you that right now. So you get on the Summit catalog. You had to be pinching yourself at this point. They liked your story. About how old were you when that all went down?
21, I believe so.
Okay, so you wanted to make the Steel City 6. You've been chosen top truck at World of Wheels. You're winning awards. You're on cloud 9. You're on the Summit catalog. And now you're thinking, I want to get to SEMA. Walk us through that.
So Good Guys has a program called the Young Guys. And they pick a car based like from all their shows, and they send it to SEMA to be in their booth. So I tried to get there that way, and I believe I got screwed on the deal because they ended the judging early and all kind of stuff. There was all kind of shady things went on out there. But, hey, who am I to say that something bad happened? You know what I mean? So I wanted to go to SEMA. So my mom sent me in to the Battle of the Builders, and the guy reached out to my mom and dad because she didn't want to tell me. They put their phone number and everything. And they reached out to him, and he's like, "Well, you guys need a booth to be in to go to SEMA." And he knew I was on the Summit catalog and everything. So he said, "Reach out to Summit." So I reached out to Summit.
This is your dad saying this?
Yeah, mom and dad. They talked to Mike something. We call him SEMA Mike.
Okay, so they talked to it's probably Mike Spagnola now that I think about it. But okay, so they talked to somebody out there. And he's like, "Hey, you got to get in if you want to get here, you got to get in a booth."
Yeah. They accepted me to be in the Battle of the Builders, but they said, you need to be in a booth to come to SEMA. So he said, reach out to your contacts at Summit and see if you can get in a booth. Well, I reached out to them, and they said, sorry, man, we have two cars in our booth already, but if something comes up, we'll let you know. Well, a couple, two, 3 days later, they call me. They say, hey, one of the guys can't get his truck done to be in our booth. Do you want to come still? And I'm like, yeah, sign me up. Like, what do I got to do?
Does a bullfrog have a watertight ass? Hell yeah. All right. All right. So the good guys thing didn't work out. Some shady stuff. Now I really want to know who ended up in the good guys booth. Do you know?
I believe his name's Justin Zimmerman. He had a 59 Impala.
All right. All right. So he's there. You get in Summit because some guy isn't able to get his truck done, and you're in the Summit booth, and you're in the Young Guns competition.
Yeah.
Then what?
Well, we make it to SEMA, and I had to be to for the judging of the Battle of the Builders when it started. It started Monday.
And this is, well, just for the audience, this is 2019. Obviously, last year there was no SEMA. It was virtual. So this is the year prior, 2019. How did you get there? You, mom, and dad trailer the truck out?
Yeah, we trailered it out.
Okay. So the truck is completely done. You've got the new chassis underneath the truck, and you're on cloud nine. You're making a long trip out from Uniontown, PA to Las Vegas, Nevada.
Yeah, 36 hours nonstop. Long ride to Vegas.
Nonstop.
Going out, we spent the night, but coming back home, we never shut the truck off. We just kept on trucking.
Oh my God, that's a feat within itself. So you show up. You said you had to be there by Monday.
Yeah, but my booth wouldn't be set up until Tuesday. So I asked them. I'm like, well, what do I got to do? Where do I got to be to get noticed? You know, to get judged. And they're like, well, there's a staging parking lot here that you have to be in. So I had to sit in this staging parking lot for 16 hours Monday to get to talk to somebody, but it was all worth it.
Yeah. That, I don't know. That's a long ass day.
Yeah.
Well, I guess it was all worth it. So Monday you're sitting in the parking lot for 16 hours, they judge the truck, and then was that it? Then Tuesday you go into Summit's booth and it's all over, and then they tell you later in the week that you won, or did you have other things you had to do?
They narrow down every couple of days. I believe Wednesday they picked the top 40, and I got in the top 40 Wednesday, and I'm like, man, this is awesome. I never thought I'd make the top 40, you know? So then I'm like, well, I made the 40. Wonder if I can make the 12. And they narrowed down the 12. I think, I forget how it went. Maybe they told you the 12 Thursday. And I'm like, man, I made the 12, you know, I might have a shot at winning the whole Young Guns division, you know, making the top four. So then Friday, they take you out of your booth and you go park in this parking lot, and then you judge the other top 12 amongst each others. And all the other builders, you get like 10 minutes to talk and sell yourself in front of all the other builders. And when I got out there, I really thought, you know, I have a chance at winning this.
How old do you have to be considered to, what's the age bracketing for the Young Guns?
Young Guns is under 27.
Okay. So you get out there. Did you have another ride that you really liked or two?
The Ring Brothers built a 69 Camaro and it was just over the top. And Pinkies, they had they call it the Three Penny Roadster. It was in the top 12 also, and just unbelievable car.
Yeah, but how could the Ring Brothers, they weren't in the Young Guns, right?
No, but they were in the top 12 overall. They weren't part of the Young Guns.
Okay, so the Young Guns is separate than the top 12. You're saying, so this is just SEMA picking all of the builds that are in the Battle of the Builders.
Yeah, they pick three of each. Like, yeah. There's four categories. There's a hot rod class, an import, a Young Guns, and then a truck and off-road class.
Yeah. So you're in the Battle of the Builders and you're like, hey, I want to compete for the Young Gun class.
Yeah.
Okay. So you like the Ring Brothers 69, and then you like the Pinkies hot rod, and any other, so the other Young Guns, how many was there in that. So just another two with you?
Yeah, just another two at that point. I don't know how many Young Guns registered overall, but at that point in the show, there was only like three of us left.
Okay. I think, if I remember right, didn't Roadster Shop bring you to the party as well on Thursday night?
I didn't go to that, no.
Oh, you didn't go? Because there was all the Young Guns. They had a whole group of the young guys there, and I think they gave away like a $500 gift award or something like that. Huh. So yeah, was there any other of the Young Guns that you really admired? Or obviously probably both of them?
Yeah, I mean, they're both incredible cars, you know. One was like a BMW of some sort with an LS motor in it, and then one was a 40 Chevy.
All right. Do you stay in contact with any of those guys anymore?
No, I talk Painthouse Randy. I don't know if you know who he is. He was one of the top truck builders when I was there. And I follow him on Instagram, and he does some really nice stuff.
I'll have to check them out. So Friday night or Thursday, you're in the top 12. You're doing the interview. How did all that go?
Rather well. I'm a rather shy guy, so it took a lot to get me out of my shell and to actually try to sell myself in front of all these people.
I couldn't tell that you were shy and didn't like to talk. For the audience, he tells me, he's like, you're going to help me on this, right? And I'm like, I'll help you on it. We'll get through it. It'll be all right. So we had actually tried to do this, I think, December of 19. We tried to do this. I reached out to you, and it just didn't work out. And then COVID hit. Man, I should have got you at some point after that. So once I had the Summit catalog in my house, and then he won, I believe it was right. I think it was probably like my end of the year one there in December 19 is when I tried to reach out to you, but we're making it happen now. He's loosening up. I've been texting him a few times. He's loosening up. It takes a little bit to get him going. So you're in the top 12. Walk us through kind of the sequence after you do your interview. How long does it take till you find out, you know, the standings?
After you do the top 12 thing, once you're done, it was like, I don't know, half hour or so maybe. They had some people come in and count, like tally up all the votes and stuff. And they bring you back up on stage and they let you know who won, you know, the top four.
So what'd you say in your interview, in your 10 minutes?
I just went over everything I did about my truck and told him why I thought my truck was awesome. You know, I told him, just to peek at it, it looks like another C10 that's painted, but you have to go beyond that and really look at it and see what all's done to it.
What seems to be one of the favorite mods that people might not see when they look at it quick, but when they dive in, you know, what's one of the things that people really kind of gravitate towards?
I cut all the drip rails off and peeked the front of the roof down to match the windshield. That's something that's like not a lot of guys do to those trucks. A lot of them leave all that stuff. So that's always like a crowd favorite. But that truck's all about the little details. You just have to really look and study all the little things to see what's done to it.
Pro Performance has been your favorite parts supplier for almost 10 years, but we're not slowing down. We've stepped up our stocking orders to make sure we have more of what you want when you want it, ready to ship or pick up at the shop. Check with us first for top brands like React Suspension, Snowden Custom Seats, Vintage Air, and Wilwood. Pro Performance is also your number one source for Dakota Digital, so whether you need a full kit or a few accessories, or just want to see the new RTX series, hit us up. Check out the website at azproperformance.com to see our full line and which shows we'll be at in 2021.
Hey guys, I've got Kathy White, Classic Performance Products, CPP on the line. Kathy, how's it going?
Hey Ronnie, what's up?
What's up? What's new?
We've got a ton of things for the C10 community. First things first, our 2.5-inch Extreme XN drop spindle. So we've upgraded the current modular spindle to modern technology. This new XN spindle is one-piece forged, but it utilizes strong, modern, bolt-in, internally sealed bearing hub assembly. So it's low maintenance, it doesn't move the wheels out, and you can use big brakes from us or any aftermarket big brakes out there in the market.
That's awesome. What else is new?
So we have actually gone back and redesigned our aluminum fuel tanks. As you know, our fuel tanks are the thickest, strongest, and largest capacity in the industry. But now you can actually use the same tank for either a carbureted or a fuel injection application. 63 to 72, it's 20 gallons. And for 73 and newer, 22-gallon capacity.
How about that coilover kit? You guys must be killing it with that thing.
That is such a great kit. It's fully bolt-on. It's easy to install. Strongest tubular arms in the market, available with either upper and lower or just the lowers or just a coilover kit by themselves. All the mounting brackets that you need, and it also comes with dual adjustable coilover shocks. So it's really responsive. It's up to you however you want to tune the compression or the rebound. It's perfect if you're just cruising on the streets, and it's proven on the track.
Well, that's what we like. So if you need spindles, the new X10, fuel tanks, coilovers, they've got it. Classic Performance Products, CPP. And don't forget, use code C10TALK, C10TALK at checkout and save 10%. Thanks, Kathy.
Thank you, Ronnie.
Marque has been in business for over 40 years. It all started in the original owner's garage. From humble beginnings of a couple parts in a garage to a two-building manufacturing facility making over 6,000 parts, Marque has grown to be one of the country's premier truck parts manufacturers. They not only design the products, but also design the tooling to build the products, guaranteeing quality control. They have made their original parts from the original trucks. Aluminum strips are double polished, creating a mirror finish and crystal clear anodized. They use the highest quality, hand-selected show quality wood that will hold up over time. Why? Because it's kiln dried to precision moisture levels specifically for Marque. They stock oak, pine, and mini exotics, guaranteeing extremely fast delivery. All parts are manufactured in-house in Oklahoma City, USA. They offer quality parts built by Americans for old American-made trucks. So when you're looking for body moldings, bed strips, bed wood, and so much more, think Marque. That's mar-k.com.
One thing that you did when you bring up the drip rail is it doesn't appear to be shaved real smooth. You kind of gave it a little, I don't know, I would say like a little peak. So it still has a definitive line there, which is cool because we know those trucks is having that line. When you take away the line completely, it appears so much different, where it appears that you still have a little bit of a body line there.
Yeah, it looks like the drip rail's there, but it's just not there. It's just built out to look like it, but it's shaved off.
How much did you end up cutting from the nose of the roof line? About an inch, or is it an inch and a half?
When they just go to like meet the windshield, they just don't line up very well. So like the corners of the roof, they were like pie cut and rolled down just to meet the roof, just to line up with the windshield.
Yeah. So, but what I mean is, and it's funny because one of the guys, I need to interview the guy, but his name's Dakota, and he did this on a C10 probably 10, 12 years ago, where, and some people might not realize this, but on a 67 to 72, the B post of the door, so the back of the, you know, your door windshield window, is lower than the front of the door where the A post meets the top of the door line. So where your wing window is at that peak, that is taller than the round of the back. So you leveled that out. How much did you end up bringing the door down?
I didn't do anything as far as like the door right there goes. It's all just stock. Just the drip rail was shaved, and then the front of the roof was just rolled down. Just okay. Pie cut right through there.
It looks like that top of the door is super level. So I thought you might have cut that front of the door down.
No, I didn't cut the front of the door down, but maybe just the way the roof rolls into the windshield now, it might just give it that like illusion.
Okay. Yeah, that might be exact. And you went with a one piece window?
Yeah.
What kit did you use?
It was from Brothers.
Yep. Okay. You got different headlights in there. You got some Fesslers.
Yeah, that's what they are, Fessler.
Body gapping is on point.
Yeah, that's like our specialty is paint and body. So you got to make sure all of that's right.
That's awesome. I love the color. Obviously, everything that you've done with it. So you're in the catalog. You're headed home 36 hours straight. Didn't turn the truck off. You got to be on a high. You won the Young Guns Award for SEMA 2019. Battle of the Builders. What do you get for that?
Nothing other than bragging rights, little glass trophy.
Yeah, you take it. You take it, right? I didn't know if somebody would, if there's like a gift, you know, like $1,000 or something, because you are a young man and, you know, you're building. What was it like, you know, on the way home thinking, man, I didn't even know if I was going to get a spot at SEMA. Somebody doesn't have a truck. I get in and now I'm on my way home from, I assume, your first time ever going to SEMA, and you win, you know, the Battle of the Builders Young Guns Award.
Yeah, first time ever at SEMA. I mean, you couldn't have asked for a better experience. I never in my wildest dreams thought I'd even make it to SEMA, let alone what I ended up doing out there. It was just, it was like it was meant to be. Everything happened in 2019 and it was just supposed to be that way. You couldn't have asked for it to work out any better. And
is there a little point of pride there in that you're, you know, I built this thing and me and my dad and small town, Union Town, PA, and we show up to the, you know, one of the biggest shows in the world, and you walk away, you know, winning some hardware?
Yeah, I mean, it really feels good because all your hard work's noticed. And, you know, I built my truck with a welder and a grinder. I don't have CNC machines and all this fancy stuff that some of these guys have, you know, like I use a drill press and a grinder for a lathe, you know, like that's what you have to do. And, you know, I don't have a big sponsored build. Like a lot of these guys out there, you know, they're sponsored builds and have unlimited funds, and everything on my truck was, you know, I bought or worked for, and it just means a lot that way.
Has that opened up some doors for you guys? Have you had people reach out? Have you had people inquire about, hey, I want to have Brad build me a truck, a car, a hot rod?
A little bit, but I think being that last year the COVID hit, it really like kind of stopped what could have happened for us. You know, I think because last year there wasn't any car shows or anything really. I think it kind of like put a hurting on what could have happened.
Well, you got to get back after it now. You guys will be back. And well, and then you fast forward to May of 2021 and you're in Classic Truck Performance. I know how it works a little slower. You probably knew for a while it was going to be in there. When did you guys shoot that?
Believe it or not, like March, April, like the guy from Classic Truck Performance messaged me on Instagram. He's like, hey man, I see you got two of these awesome trucks. He's like, if I could shoot them both, it's worth my time to come out and shoot them. And I'm like, yeah, when do you want to do it? And he's like, this week. I'm like, well, we can arrange that.
Cool. Cool. So when he talks about a second truck, I'm assuming that's the 59 that you built.
Yeah, the 59.
Okay. What's going on with that?
Like I said earlier, we have one customer that he just lets us do whatever we want. He trusts us with everything. That's his. We actually just came back from a Good Guys show in Raleigh, and it got a Truck of the Year early pick. And so that's like awesome.
So what's the big difference working on a task force or a C10 when you think about that journey? And what'd you learn from the difference?
The older the truck is, the cruder it is. It needs more work to be, you know, brought up to my standards.
Even if you were handed a 71 in pieces?
Yeah, I would say, because this 59, it was bad. I mean, we used the back of the cab and the hood.
Sounds like we need to get you some Arizona trucks out there to start with.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you guys like that paint and body stuff. So you won Truck of the Year earlier. You're in the running. So you're in for that based upon taking it to a Good Guys event. That's got to be a good feeling for you. What's next?
We have a Pantera in the shop now we're working on, and a Nova. I don't have anything of my own right now that I'm working on, but, you know, I'm always looking for that something that catches my eye for my next project.
Would you say that you're a C10 guy? I know you got the C10. It was gifted to you. You built it. You know, I'm not saying it's the truck of your dreams, but maybe it is now. Are you hooked on that body style, or do you have another body style that you'd like to build?
There are definitely one of my favorites. I'd say there's nothing better than one. I don't know if I'd want to build another one though, because, you know, C10s are so hot right now. It's hard to get noticed with something everyone else is building. So I almost think if I do another build, it might be something a little more off the wall.
Like what? What would you build?
I'm kind of like these like 30 style Ford, like fenderless roadster trucks. I seen a girl named Danielle has one, a blue one that Jason Graham built. And I've just liked it ever since. So something of that style, because they're real small trucks. And I think you can make everything about it perfected a lot easier than something that's so big like a C10.
Yeah, it's funny to hear you say that, because you just got done saying that the older it is, the more unforgiving they are, or the rougher they are. But hell, some of those, they just make so many different aftermarket parts for them. You can build it and buy it out of a catalog practically.
Yeah. And like I said, with like no fenders or anything, just a body and a hood and a bed, like there's minimal pieces to it that have to be perfect and all everything line up. And where like these C10s, you have inside the bed, outside the bed, underneath, inner fenders, fenders. There's just so many pieces where like one of those, you're just like a little body.
Yeah. Yeah, that'd be cool. It'd be cool to kind of see what you end up doing. Have you had anybody reach out to you about the C10, the 71? Anybody want to buy it from you?
I've had several people mention it. I'm not sure how serious they are, but I don't think I want to sell it. I don't want to part with it.
At least not now.
Yeah.
So what would you tell somebody who's a kid out there? He's in his shop class. He's in automotive. Maybe he doesn't have quite the influence, you know, and or dad that helped him along the way, but you know, he wants to be a builder and he's looking, you know, maybe somebody like you look to a guy like Chip Foose, and now somebody who's a young kid who's 8th, 9th grade, he hears this, he sees, you know, that you won the Young Guns Award for Battle of the Builders. What kind of advice would you give those young guys and girls out there that are trying to get a career in automotive?
If that's your passion, just stick with it. I mean, you know, you don't have to come from an automotive family or anything to get into the automotive industry. I mean, if that's your passion, if you think you can do it, go for it. There's nobody stopping you but you.
Do you have some goals for your career? I mean, some classes. Would you like to become a metal fabricator, a better painter? This is a weakness of mine. I wish I could wire better. Is there anything that you're, as a young guy, I think you said you're 24 now, you've got some really kick-ass hardware for such a young man. What's next for your career mantle?
I'd like to learn like a little more like fabricating, like metal shaping type of stuff. That's something I don't really know a whole lot about, but we make some pretty trick parts for what we've done. But, you know, some of those fabricators now, they're just out there. Like, I don't know how they even do some of that stuff. But I'd like to learn a little more about that type of end of it.
Well, there is two guys that are out there. One's Josh Hart and one is Jeff Volker. And those two are absolutely a tornado together, because they built some of the just baddest, raddest shit. I bet old Hart Fab would love to have you for a month or two if you could. If you ever slow down at the shop in Uniontown, and he could probably use the help. He'd probably be one of those things where we get you sent over there and you do an internship, but you'd learn a lot about metal fab, and then you'd probably be able to help him out and he'd probably pay you. I think every time I talk to the guy, he's so swamped. He's so far behind. But for the audience, that's Hart Fab, Josh Hart. He was episode, I don't know, I think he was my first guest in 2019, my first episode of 2019, but such a great guy, great for the scene. He does a lot of metal fab and bead rolling type stuff. I'm sure you've heard of him.
Mm-hmm. He's a rather local guy too, I believe.
Yeah, they're all out of Pittsburgh. Both Jeff and Josh are right there. So I'm not sure exactly how far. I think Jeff is in Pittsburgh, pretty much more in the industrial part of town. Both have been previous guests of the show. They're great guys, and they're building really cool stuff. So I'm sure if you wanted to expand your horizons on that. So right now it's you and Dad, nobody else in the shop, and you guys are taking on, what, 2-3 vehicles at a time?
Yeah, just me and Dad. Sometimes we have 2, 3, 4, 5, just depending on how much space we have at the time. We have a rather small shop. You know, you can't take on too many projects at once.
Do you have a vehicle that, you know, you hope comes through the door someday that you can work on?
Nothing really. I mean, sometimes these odd things are cool. Like I said, we have a Pantera now that we're going to restore. We worked on an old MG, like a 53 MG, before we restored it. And sometimes the kind of odd things are neat, but nothing really in particular that I hope for.
How funny is that? A 53 MG versus a 71 C10. You know, I mean, just how small everything is, and you know, just we're so spoiled. At least I think, you know, you kind of talked about the Ford, you know, the early Ford versus your C10, and you know, just 9/16, half inch, and you could take a whole truck apart. You know what I mean? Versus the 53 MG, I'm assuming is a lot of small stuff.
Believe it or not, a 53 MG, it's all its own. It's British standard. It's not standard or metric. You have your own special set of tools for it and everything. It's some goofy stuff.
Believe me, I believe you. I believe you. I believe you. Hand me the Phillips. No, that's not going to work. Hand me a straight. No, that's not going to work. Shit, I don't know what the hell to take this thing. We got to go to the store and get some new tools. So what's your company name? You and your dad have a shop?
Yeah, our shop name's Hey Man Creations. Everybody around knows him from, like, you know, doing body work before. And he always was like, there's a lot of Swaneys that do body work. So we wanted something that was just different and stood out from all of that. We didn't really want the Swaney name in it. So Hey Man, we're actually on Hey Man Road, is where we live and grew up and our shop is. So we just thought that would fit.
I mean, if I didn't know you were on Hey Man, I would just think it was so cool because you're like, hey man.
Yeah, that's what a lot of people think until you explain it.
Yeah, you're like, hey man, you guys almost need like a cool reggae style shirt or something. It's like, hey man, hey man. Yeah, I'm on. All right, cool. Oh, I think I might've lost you. Oh, you're back. Okay. All right. Let's wrap it up. Let you go. We appreciate you not only staying a little later at the shop tonight. We're going to push you out to the world. Hope to see your truck in person. Is there a show that you haven't made it to that you'd like to either bring your truck or attend just in person to come out to a show?
I'm going to go to the GM Carlisle, like the Truck Nationals or something like that. I forget exactly what it's called, but I've never been to it, and everyone tells me that it's like a judge show and they think my truck would do really well at it. So we're going to give it a whirl. It's in August.
Yeah. So Carlisle, PA. So that's right there for you as well. And you've never been in that to any Carlisle show?
No, I haven't. My dad's been like years ago, but I've never been to any of them.
All right. Yeah. That'll be interesting. So you're going to head up there and you've already probably got it registered and ready to rock, and you're going to go in August.
Yeah, we're going to take that. And I believe that 59 truck we did, he's going to take it also.
All right. Well, hopefully, maybe you'll end up in the top two with both those trucks. That'd be kind of funny if they kind of shook out that way. Do you have any other truck, or I'm sorry, any other show that you'd like to attend, you know, whether it was with your truck or just you and your dad flying out to, you know, a Detroit Autorama, a Florida show, you know, any other show? You've been to SEMA, anything else?
I've never been to Detroit. I always wanted to go, but we've just never went. So that's definitely on the list.
Cool. Well, I think with the connections that you've made, obviously you're the recipient of the Battle of the Builders Young Gun, that people, it's still going to open doors for you if you choose for it to. And, you know, good for you. Congratulations on not only Summit, not only winning, you know, the different awards for your truck, but the Battle of the Builders. You're in the May issue of Classic Truck Performance. A lot of pinch me moments for you. Mm-hmm. What's your dad think about all this?
Oh, he loves it. He's in awe.
Cool. Dad have anything that he wants to build now?
He has a Nova right now, a 65 Nova, and he's had it for 40 years. It was his first car, and it's like kind of pro street, pro touring. It has flush mount glass and everything in it. He did. He cut the roof down. It's really sweet car.
So a 65, that's still considered like a Chevy 2, right? It's pretty small.
Yeah.
All right. Is that, I know a lot of guys make like pro streets out of them. Is he kind of wanted to be more of a hot rod, a pro street? What's he thinking?
Well, it's already done. It's like previous car. It has Art Morrison chassis in it and everything. So
it's ready to go. So he's done with it, or he wants to restore it?
No, it's done. It's just, he has it.
How about your mom? Is she into the cars and trucks, or does she just, you know, kind of, she's just proud of her boys?
She's along for the ride. We actually bought her a 62 Impala we're going to build for her. So.
Okay. So that's next?
Yeah, it's down the shop now. We're trying to figure out what direction we want to go with it still.
Oh, boy. Does she know what she's getting herself into?
She's not sure yet.
All right, Brad. Well, thank you for taking time out of your day. Thanks for sharing your story, and congratulations on, you know, winning everything that you have with your truck, and you know, just great things ahead for you. We hope you, your dad, and the Hey Man Creations, and we can't wait to see what you do next.
Thanks. Thanks a lot for having me. It was awesome.
Okay, brother. Take care.
All right. You too.
Pretty awesome story, right? Kid gets the truck, gets a little sidetrack, gets back to the truck, and then kicks ass with the truck. So I thought you guys would like that one. I sure did. If you haven't had a chance, check out 214 and 215. Let us know how we're doing. Rate, review, share the pod. You know the email, Ronnie@TruckTalkMedia, if you got something to say. And I think I'm going to be off next week, so you won't have a pod next week. I'll give you time to check out or get caught up on the previous weeks, and I'll be back after that, okay? Thanks again for tuning in and getting behind us on the summer sale. We do appreciate it. Until 217, late.
That's all, folks.